Saket Agarwal, good morning and thank you for joining us in this interview with India Global Business. We're very happy to have you with us. I just doing a little bit of reading of about you. You are the founder and managing partner of Onivation. Your interests lie in the India business of Israeli deep tech companies. You help them grow in India by providing local teams with capital and driving sales and growth. Your company is now become one of the leading contributors to the growing relationship between Israel and India. Apart from your interest in Israel, you are an active angel investor, and you're also a mentor at the NASSCOM Deep Tech Club and WeWork Labs, where you help startups with strategy and go to market. Your company, Onivation, has a portfolio of 15 companies in the areas of e-commerce, retail, data science, analytics, AI, cloud security, marketing, and ad tech space. So thank you very much for taking the time out to speak to us. You are also referred to as your Israel guy, given your specialty on everything that pertains to Israel.
Thank you for having me. Really a pleasure.
So Saket, I just want to kick off this discussion with you, given your deep knowledge about the Israel ecosystem and the way they do business. The India-Israel collaboration has been there for many decades. Tech has become a global buzzword now. And India and Israel are also collaborating on tech. However, given the size between the two countries, it seems that the roles are in reverse. It's virtually like startup India is meeting startup nation, which is Israel. When I last checked, there were about 6,000 Israeli startups. That's a staggering number. Where do you think the future areas of convergence and benefits lie now for both countries?
That's a great question. I'll share a few data points. If you look at the Israeli tech ecosystem, startups in Israel last year raised about $4 billion in funding and $23 billion in exits. Okay. And there are like 300 R&D centers in Israel. All the top multinationals, they set up an R&D center because the best of deep tech or talent lies there. On the other hand, if you see India as a market, we're looking at about 100 unicorns by 2025, considering the growth we are seeing. On one side, we are seeing Indian companies which are achieving massive scale, solving for large consumer bases, right? Where we are talking about how do we solve digital health, how do we solve access to, medicine, access to consultation. On the other hand, Israel is solving for more backend deep tech stuff, which is around solving for cybersecurity, data science, analytics, ad tech, or user profiling. Both these countries need each other. Israel needs access to a large market. Currently, they've only been relying on the US. And now, because India is growing so fast, they've also started looking at India. On the other hand, Indian companies are growing so fast, they need very, very strong technology to sustain that scale. And with this, I would like to say that we've just started this journey of bridging the gap. And both these countries will play a very, very important role in helping each other grow. Other than the technology front, I feel tourism and culture are two other very important nuances or domains where both the countries can play a big role. Every time as an Indian I've gone to Israel, I've received a lot of love and affection because Israelis, when they come to India, they receive the same. And it seems like literally my second home. So I feel there's a big play for tourism to expand. And because of tourism and cultural exchanges, as you increase the bonding and love, businesses also grow and development also grows.
That's a very good point you raised, which brings me to my next question. What is the one area that you find or the areas of commonality that you see that brings these two nations traditionally and naturally so close together across diverse fields. India and Israel share an understanding on a lot of issues. Having been to Israel so often, what is your takeaway from that?
Yeah, I think the way I look at it is, you know, the idea of never giving up. Both the countries really endorse it in a big way. If you look at Israel, Israel's been at war from several countries. And if they do not innovate, they won't sustain. They won't be able to survive, right? So they always keep innovating and bringing new technologies. India, on the other hand, has a very complex problem of scale and diversity, right? So many languages, so many cities, you know, religions. And still there is one prime minister who's managing the whole country in a, you know, amicable way. So I feel the whole idea of solving a problem is very deeply rooted in both the countries. And that is what is making it unique and, you know, the spirit of getting together.
So this, for us now in India, the new wave is all about Atmanirbhar Bharat. Is it the same mindset that the Israelis share when they are innovating within in their own internal space?
Yeah, pretty much. Like Israel is always about, you know, first solving for themselves. So, you know, every person who is 18 years and above has to join the military in Israel. And then they're all about protecting themselves first. Right. And hence they end up building a lot of technology. And then they're like, how do we help the world solve those problems as well? You know, once we come out of the military, that's how the model is. And I see India also evolving in a way where so many new startups are coming out of India, which are now targeting the US market or solving for the global markets. So I see less reliance on China going forward, and more on countries that are solving global problems.
As a regular visitor to Israel who invests in business opportunities, who imbibes the culture, the social offerings that the country has, what are the areas that really fascinates you? Because Israel as a country has a lot of fascination for me also. But since you have been there so often, and you are dubbed as the Your Israel guy, What fascinates you, or what has always fascinated you about Israel, Saqib?
I can give you a backstory of how you know, Israel does what it does, and then I'll talk about how it fascinated me. Like I was mentioning, that every individual has to join the army once they finish their school. One of the things they're doing is intercepting missile attacks. Right, when you're intercepting missile attacks, you're getting a lot of data and then analyzing a lot of data, right? So a lot of data science analytics companies come out of Israel. When you have so much data, you have to store it in the cloud. Now, because it's military data, they can't be hosted on a public cloud. So they build their own data centers. And then they learn how to manage those data centers. Third, they have to be very sure about the security of the data. So they build great cybersecurity companies while they are, you know, young and in the military. So 20% of world's funding on cybersecurity goes to Israeli cybersecurity startups, and the population is just 9 million. And the fourth thing that I noticed about the military culture was, you know, advertising and marketing. So before you enter Israel, the government literally knows everything about you, if you are a threat to the nation or not. Basically, they're profiling you. And profiling is a very important aspect of advertising and marketing. They, you know, we target you basis who you are as a person, right? So I feel all these four pillars really make it a strong foundation for any digital economy to grow. You need strong data analytics. You know, it could be the citizen data to be processed for any service that the government wants to provide. You need to have strong cloud capabilities to process that efficiently. You need to be very, very sure about the security. India is now going very strict on data privacy laws, and, you know, cybersecurity plays a big role. And then profiling is again very, very interesting in terms of, you know, the large consumer base that we are seeing. How do we reach the right consumer at the right time? Right now, these are just fundamentals which I felt would fit into every large consumer enterprise that India is building. If I look at the broader segments, I'm very passionate about future of food, future of health, digital health, and industry 4.0. As we grow as a nation, we will start having shortage of meat, for example, and then artificial meat will come into picture. Digital health is becoming a big issue now because of COVID. People have stopped visiting or at least refraining from visiting a hospital or a clinic. Can we provide healthcare sitting at home? Can you do a urine test sitting at home using your mobile device? Or, you know, the third aspect is Industry 4.0, which I shared. You know, how do you prevent downtimes? In India, we lose so much time because of, you know, productivity issues, right? If a machine is not working or a employee at the factory is not working well, how do you bring efficiency to the daily lives of people? Which is where I feel all these backgrounds, all the background that Israeli folks have from the military, the experience of solving deep tech, really adds value to the scale that India can give them.
The Israeli philosophy, when it comes to working in partnerships, they don't work with everybody. As you said, they assess. And yet, they choose to work with a country as vast and diverse in so many ways, like with India. So share a bit about their culture with us, the work culture, the business culture.
So I'll give you two simple analogies. When I go to Israel, I feel like a kid in a candy store. It's super tempting. Everyone's solving like a problem. Someone's making a battery that charges your phone in 5 minutes. Someone's making a suit that can help someone on the wheelchair stand up and walk again. And when you look at these innovations, you're like, why is it not in India? Like when you go to the US, you feel like, why is Tesla not in India yet, right? One key learning from that is that not every technology is necessarily suited for the Indian market. Okay, India has a large population, not necessarily a large market for every product, right? I'll explain, you know, the implications of this. The second thing, when you are in Israel from a partnership standpoint, it's like, you know, you're in an IPL team bidding, you know, event, where, you know, you're a team owner, you want to build a great team. Now, you want Sachin Tendulkar, Virendra Sehwag, Virat Kohli, but they may not want you, right? So how do you like position yourself? Plays a very, very important role there, right? So let me explain. One piece with Israel is that they are extremely conscious about who do they want to spend their time with. Time is of big essence to them. They really value time is, you know, they really value the concept of time is money, right? And if it's a really good company, imagine if it's Virat Kohli in a, you know, IPL bidding event, every team wants him, right? Similarly, if it's a great company in Israel, every person in the world wants to work with it, right? So you got to have a very strong, compelling proposition in order for them to spend time with you. Few things that I followed when I went to Israel. I'm an accountant by qualification. And the first company I got into India is a company that helps you optimize your cloud cost. So I was wondering, like, you know, why would they work with me? And they were wondering the same, how could I help? At that time, all I said was, you know, like, I know two companies in India that could potentially be your customer. Let us give a small shot. Let me at least get you an introduction. Let's get started. And they were like, okay, not much to lose. Let's give it a shot. I came back to India, got them those introductions. We closed those two deals. And that's how I started my business. So many times we overpromise and underdeliver. In Israel, underpromising, being very humble about your connections is very important. And once you deliver, then, you know, the whole country works on trust. Everyone knows everyone. Before you want to work with someone, they would do 5 reference checks on you because they don't trust you. And once they are, you know, once they see the results, they will go all out to support you and be your long lasting partner. So this specific piece I feel is very, very important. And you know, the idea of not getting excited by everything when you go to Israel, don't be the kid in the candy store. Be very conscious of what is actually relevant for the market here, and you're not wasting their time in your time.
The world is changing dramatically post-COVID, and will change post-COVID, and it is changing during the COVID. We have seen a lot of developments happening across the world, and I'm based in the UAE. There has been for many decades a blocking out of Israel, and now the blockages have all been removed. Many countries in the GCC and the Middle East have now reached out to Israel. And the aggression with which business collaborations are going on now is very, very interesting. UAE and Israel now are on a really aggressive fast track for economic collaboration. And you know that India, as a business entity, as a cultural entity, is very well entrenched in the UAE, has very strong bilateral ties, and India also enjoys very strong bilateral ties with Israel. In the emergence of these renewed ties between the two countries, Israel and the UAE, what is your idea of the potential that exists in the end game? What do you think? Where can India benefit from this?
Oh, I think it can benefit a lot. I was waiting for something like this to happen. So let me explain, you know, UAE and Israel tying up right now has just happened, and it will take at least a year or year and a half for people to get familiar with each other's cultures, nuances, you know, political ecosystem. And there is still some level of, you know, uncertainty. People are still like, you know, there, but not there, where they're, you know, what if the government changes their decision, something happens. I think that's where Indians play a very, very strong role. Every top CEO in UAE or C-level executive at a large company in UAE is an Indian, right? Who's running the shots. The fact that we are already there and there is an, you know, a different country wanting to come and expand their business in UAE, which will actually help them transform, you know, the UAE companies to transform their growth. Indians can play a big role in catalyzing it, right? And, you know, let's take an example of a system integrator like a Tech Mahindra or an Infosys. Earlier, if they were to, you know, co-sell an Israeli SaaS product into UAE, it would be very, very difficult for them. Because of that, they would lose some revenue opportunistically. Now, a Tech Mahindra can partner with the best of Israeli companies, take them to the UAE and build a lot of services on top of it, right? And Israel is actually producing so many of these technologies which did not exist in the past, right? That's their DNA, which would first go to the US, would stay there for 10, 20 years, and then come to India, UAE, or you know, the Southeast Asian markets. Now there is direct window of opportunity for Indians to, you know, partner with Israelis and expanding the UAE markets.
Saket, the current areas of interest across global industries with the pandemic, tech has suddenly emerged as a game changer.
Yeah.
So you have in fields like e-commerce, retail, data science, analytics, AI, cloud, security, marketing, ad tech space. These are the current things that have become the buzzwords in the industries across the world.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wearing your hat as a expert, where do you see in your area of preference, where does the future lie between India-Israel collaboration and beyond?
Yeah, like I said, in general, I feel data, cloud, cybersecurity are three key pillars for you know, any economy to grow, right? And all the applications it drives, right? From food, healthcare, you know, government, IoT, Industry 4.0. So I believe we've just started scratching the surface from a collaboration point of view. There is a lot of innovation that is happening. We've personally invested in so many of these companies. And as you see, like the largest of corporations are now hiring digital transformation experts, chief digital officers, because they realize that if they do not change, they won't sustain. So I feel technology adoption will in general increase. Cloud, data science, cybersecurity will play a big pillar, will be three big pillars of that. And I would encourage everyone to sort of strongly look at these areas.
But I would also like to ask you about the vision for your company, Onnovation. Where did you start and where do you see it going? Please explain. Take us on this journey with you.
Yeah, sure. So it's a very interesting journey. I started, 5 years ago. I'm an accountant by qualification, born and brought up in Calcutta. And I was wondering, how to evolve, how to make use of the growth the world is seeing and be part of that. Learned about Israel, went for a trip, 17 days trip, met 100 companies, seeing can I bring them into India and run their business, do a joint venture. And I ended up meeting a company which helps you save a cost on your cloud bills. That time I did not even know what cloud was. Cloud was cloud for me. But I learned the whole game. And over a period of time, I realized that we are generating so much value for this company and about 15 companies that now we have JVs with. We started thinking, why not start investing in these companies, right? So from a pure JV model, we thought, let us also be part of the long-term growth of these companies. And over a period of, last few years, we've invested in 20 different companies, venture capital funds, with an objective, if we are investing in these companies, we also help you with revenue, with sales, considering we already have a sales team. And sales is actually the single biggest value that you can add to any company that has software to sell. So in 2 years, we want to launch a big fund where we'll say, if you are a startup, you are raising capital, you come to us, but we are going to get you a couple of million in ARR the moment you start working with us, because we already have a customer base. We already have the know-how of how to sell. Which I feel would be a big differentiator for us as we grow big. Yeah, so that's the vision, becoming one of the largest venture capital funds in the world with sales as a strategic value add.
Saket, coming back, looking into the future and given your broad experience on Israel, my personal view, and you may obviously agree or disagree with that the Israel India relationship has barely scratched the surface. Am I right in saying that?
Absolutely. I agree. We've barely started scratching the surface also because I think although the two countries, the people love each other, there are small nuances of working with Israelis, and Israelis also need to understand how to work with Indians. It's more of a communication skill, learning than anything else. How do we communicate? How do we understand? Somehow I've been, able to crack that over a period of time. But I think that one piece can really play a big role.
Saket, one thing I found very fascinating about your profile is your hashtag, which is Your Israel Guy. Can you explain to us the process of what made you give yourself this hashtag and this identity? I'm very fascinated to know.
So it's a very interesting question. I get this a lot. One of the learnings I had was, how do you capitalize on, a brand that is already built? The fact that I started 5 years ago when the India-Israel relationships were, very nascent. Tech collaborations were barely anything. And that is when I started, bridging the gap very aggressively. Because of that effort, where I was one of the only few guys in Israel bringing companies to India, and then Indians hearing Israel for the first time, it used to happen that in meetings, everyone who would mention Israel as a word, they would be like, okay, do you guys know Onnovation? Do you guys know Saket? Right? And it barely, it pretty much became like a synonym where anyone in India talking about Israel has to know us. And I thought, why not, make it more loud And, you know, hence I tagged it as my Your Israel Guy.
Saket, my final question to you is, you are going to remain in the Israel-India ecosystem and you're going to do your business there. If there was one thing that you like, or if there's one thing that you can change in the current modalities of where business is being conducted, what would it be?
That's a great question. I feel, you know, on the Israel side, I would like to promote India as a much more stronger and business-friendly country. I think there's still a perception that India is not an easy market to work with, because people take forever to take decisions, prices are not, you know, you don't get the same pricing that you get in the US market, which I don't believe in now. You know, we sell the same products that they would sell in the US at the same prices in India, right? So I think the market has evolved. So a little bit of positive branding of India as a strong market would really help. On the India front, of course, there is very little awareness about the things that are happening in Israel. I feel if there is more awareness, you know, like we are doing this interview, a lot of Indian consumer companies will start looking at evolving faster using the best of tech from Israel. And I think these are two areas I would focus on.
Saket Agarwal, thank you so much for giving us your time. Your insights are absolutely fascinating. I read a lot about Israel, but I personally learned a lot from this interview with you. So I'm really appreciative that you gave India Global Business your time. And we hope to stay in touch with you again and again and again.
Thank you for having me. Really appreciate it.